This is Athletics After Dark. Now, here's your host, Dale Tafoya.
Welcome, Oakland A's fans across the globe. My name is Dale Tafoya, and it is Monday, February 18th, 2013. And this is podcast number 105. And first of all, we want to wish everyone out there listening a happy President's Day. And it is spring training, people. The A's are coming off a truly magical, inspirational, riveting season that really rejuvenated and united an entire fan base. And tonight, we're privileged to have longtime radio voice of the A's and a man who called many of those magical games last season. He's Ken Korach, who joins us from Arizona. Ken has called A's games on the radio since 1996, and right now he's immersed in a project that he is passionate about, and a great deal of fans are too. Ken is writing a book about his broadcast partner of 10 years, the late play-by-play legend Bill King, former radio voice of the Warriors, Raiders, and your Oakland A's. The book, which is titled Holy Toledo, Lessons from Bill King, Renaissance Man of the Mic, will be available in a few months, I'm told, and is being published by Steve Kepman's Wellstone Books. Ken, first of all, thank you for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me, Dale. It's going to be a lot of fun to talk with you.
Yes. Tell us about the birth of this project, Ken, and what compelled you to write a book about Bill King.
Well, stop me, Dale, if I get a little long-winded, because I'm pretty passionate, like you said, about the subject of Bill King.
But, take your time.
I guess if you go back a few years, I was approached by a publisher who had the idea of me writing a book, but it was certainly a different topic than pursuing a Bill King book. And it kind of got me started, Dale, in thinking that if I was going to write a book, you have to do something you have a passion for. And that maybe you can make a little difference and send a positive message with a book. And I didn't really want to do something that was autobiographical. So I thought that if I was going to do a book, that Bill King, there's so much subject matter, as you can imagine, Dale, when it pertains to Bill. And I guess there's always been a part of me that's wanted to write a book, and the challenge of it, just to see if I had the discipline and the wherewithal to actually sit down and try to do the interviews and do the book. And I kind of always wondered if I could do that, if I could accomplish that. And then, as you said, Dale, Steve Kepman has been a good friend for a long time. And when I first joined the A's, as you said, back in 1996, Steve was the beat writer, was on the A's beat for the Chronicle. We became pretty good friends back then. And Bill was close with Steve. They knew each other very well. Steve actually did a little essay segment on our preview shows back then that ran 3 or 4 days a week. And so Steve, like I did, grew up listening to Bill. And I think kind of shared my interest in Bill and the passion we both had and respect that we had for Bill. And so as things turned out, over the years after Steve left the Chronicle, he has become a very accomplished author and has written several books, at least I think 3 of them have appeared on the New York Times bestseller list.
Sure.
And so he kind of gave me the push that I needed. And it was shortly after this last baseball season that I got a call from Steve. And as you said, he started a kind of a fledgling enterprise that I think is going to turn out to be a wonderful thing for Steve. And also for the the book community in general. And that is that he founded Wellstone Books. And so to have someone as accomplished as Steve, who also shared an interest in Bill, he gave me the push to go ahead and try to pursue this project. And Steve is serving not only as the publisher of the book, but as the editor, at least the primary editor for the book. So for me, Dale, to have this opportunity to work with someone like Steve on a project like this is just an opportunity that doesn't come around every day.
It sounds like a perfect match and the perfect timing, Ken. And, you know, communicating with Steve, the publisher, there's a sense of amazement, Ken, that the more you dive into the life of Bill King, For example, not only was Bill brilliant as painting an accurate and entertaining description of a game, he was literally an above-average artist, painter. In your research, how has discovering new things about Bill changed your perception of him?
Well, I think from that standpoint, I'll answer that. I'll get to that in a second. First of all, you mentioned how multifaceted he is. And the more we dived into this, the more we got immersed in it. And I feel a little guilty because I think because of that, it's caused Steve to have a lot more work to bring this project to fruition. Because Dale initially, he had broached the subject with me. And I thought he had a great idea of doing a shorter book. That Steve had an idea to kind of almost kick off Wellstone Books with what he was going to call a mentor series of books that were shorter, maybe 80 or 100 pages, in which people like myself, who had a great experience with someone like Bill, would write a very personal reflection on those experiences of people whose lives were touched by that individual. Well, as I got more and more into the book, Dale, and started to pursue doing a lot of interviews, and I've done, I don't know how many, 20 or 30 interviews for the book so far, it became very clear to me and also to Steve that I wanted to tell the story and go beyond just my own personal experience with Bill. It is a personal book, and there are those reflections. But because Bill touched and enriched so many lives, as you know, Dale, I also felt it was very important to tell his story through the eyes and through the voices of a lot of other people as well. So it's kind of ballooned as a project into many, many more pages than I think we had initially planned on. But I knew, Bill and I were very close, Dale, in those 10 years. And, of course, I grew up listening to him. So even before I had met Bill, I felt like he was a member of the family. And I guess in kind of the romantic sense of what we do as broadcasters, that's the way I think it's supposed to be. So nothing has really surprised me about really fully understanding the breadth of Bill's talents and his interests. But the thing that really has energized me the most is with every interview that I've done, I've hung up the phone, or in the case of a Hank Greenwald where Steve and I had lunch with Hank, I've just gotten more and more energized over the project because so many people have a passion for Bill and for talking about Bill. And when they talk and reflect about Bill and the time they spent with him, it all comes from the heart. You think about someone like Bill who had such a profound impact, not only on broadcasting, but on so many other people as well. And so that was the number one thing that I think kind of blew me away.
Mm-hmm. And Bill has been nominated as a 4 Frick Award finalist, which is presented annually for excellence in broadcasting by the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum multiple times, Ken, since his death in 2005. He finished in second place in last year's voting, and many feel his time is coming soon. But that's a baseball-related honor. And sometimes we forget that Bill was already 54 years old when he became the A's radio voice in 1981. I mean, there are some broadcasters who started calling baseball games in their early 20s. So to think that he started his body of work with the A's at the age of 54 and right now is still considered one of the game's elite announcers in history is remarkable.
That's true, and it's a great point. And, of course, he was so multidimensional. The fact that he started with the Warriors in 1962, he started with the Raiders in 66, and like you said, it wasn't until 81 that he was paired with Lon Simmons with on the A's broadcast, which was an incredible move, by the way, on the part of the A's organization. And through the research in doing the book, Steve has talked to Wally Haas. I've interviewed Andy Dolich and Roy Eisenhardt. And both Andy and Roy would tell you, Dale, that for all the success the team had on the field, and Tony Bruce said, of course, beginning when Bill was first joined with Lon, it was very much still the Billy Ball era with the club. The hiring of Bill King and the pairing of Bill King and Lon Simmons was maybe the most significant move the A's made to establish credibility in the Bay Area back in 1981. But one thing, too, I think people need to remember is that Bill had a long history with baseball that dated far before he started working for the club back in 81, Dale, because If you look back at the 1950s, he started doing minor league baseball in the Midwest. And his history with broadcasting minor league games dates back to the days when they recreated games. He didn't travel for the road games, and he was in a studio, and the very bare minimum details would come over the teletype, and those were very influential days for Bill in developing his skills as a broadcaster. Then he actually worked on the Giants broadcast beginning in 1959, and he spent 3 or 4 years with the legendary broadcast team of Lon Simmons and the Russ Hodges back in those days. So the thing about Bill is that he was incredible with the Raiders and the Warriors, and I grew up, like so many people did, listening to him broadcast those games. Baseball really was Bill King's first love.
Sure. The voice you're hearing is Ken Korach, the radio voice of the A's and author of the forthcoming book, Holy Toledo, Lessons from Bill King, Renaissance Man of the Mic. And Ken, when I remember Bill King, of course, to me, he was a master at describing what he saw in a game, and he prepared meticulously. But aside from his craft in a broadcaster's booth, this man was unique. I mean, he did it his way. There's stories where he wouldn't pay over $250 for a car. When he was calling games for the Raiders, he'd be on the sidelines at training camp wearing Speedo swimming trunks and flip-flops. He had a wax handlebar mustache with a goatee. Columnist Ray Ratto once wrote of Bill, the only reason he did not become nationally known and admired was that he wouldn't shave his beard to appease television producers. He didn't want to, and he didn't have to. How will your book can capture his uniqueness?
Well, that's a great question, Dale. And to be honest with you, when I started writing the book, those things you mentioned are daunting. How do you actually capture Bill King? Because he was such a brilliant man. I think he was the greatest broadcaster, greatest sportscaster this country's ever produced. And then to try to really understand him, it's daunting. It's a little intimidating, I think. But all we can do is our best and try to write from the heart and from our own experiences, and also, as I said, to try to kind of deliver the message of Bill through the voices of a lot of different people. But he did, as Roy Eisenhart said, he had a multiversity of talents. But he was just so amazing in so many ways. Like you mentioned, his painting. We used to spend a lot of time together going to art museums on the road, which was something that I had always enjoyed even before Bill and I became partners. And just recently, Steve Kepman actually was able to firsthand go and see some of his paintings up in Sausalito. And Kathy and Johnny, who, Bill helped raise, Bill's wife Nancy had two kids, Kathy and Johnny, and Bill became really a father to those two kids, and they became extremely close. And so I have one of Bill's paintings hanging in my den back home. He was very well versed, as you know, in Russian history. He taught himself how to speak Russian. He sailed the Black Sea. He was a very accomplished sailor. He sailed to Hawaii and back, sailed up to British Columbia. He did a lot of very unique things that you wouldn't associate necessarily with kind of a jock mentality. He was much deeper than that. He was very involved in the opera and the ballet, spent a lot of time in the 60s up in North Beach going to concerts and immersing himself in jazz. So all those stories will be told in the book. And again, through people like a Tom Mascheri, who Bill was very close with, and through Rick Barry's eyes, and even John Madden, who was very gracious to allow me to interview him one day. And Madden had this great quote about Bill, Dale, when he said that, when you're coaching football, you're so immersed in it. It's every day. It consumes you 24 hours a day. And Madden said that when he spent time with Bill, it helped him get away from that because Bill was involved in so many other things. And the quote from Madden was that Bill King was a great getaway guy because he helped me get away from football.
Mm-hmm. Well, just like Bill King can, this podcast is about the Oakland A's, but Bill transcended baseball. And it's good to hear that you're going to weave his different sports into your book.
Yeah, well, absolutely. You can't tell the story of Bill without telling him. I was such a big fan of the Warriors. even though I grew up in Los Angeles, but I could hear the listen to the Warrior games at night. And I loved all those teams in the 60s. I mean, even going back to when Chamberlain played for the Warriors. And then, of course, when they won the championship in 75. And that was, I'm giving away a lot of stuff from the book, but Bill felt that was his favorite year, I think, as a broadcaster, at least as it pertained to the time that he did the Warriors, that 1975 Warrior season. And there's some wonderful reflections from Rick Barry in the book talking about that year.
Sure. And Ken, there is a trend among broadcasters in baseball and in other professional sports where some broadcasters feel pressured to be cheerleaders for their teams, you know, quote unquote, homers. And I'm not being critical of that approach, but Bill King described what he saw and not what someone pressured him to say. He was critical when it was warranted, and listeners knew they were going to get undiluted play-by-play from him, the real deal. And that was his conviction as a broadcaster, to be objective. How did his style rub off on you as a young broadcaster?
Well, I think it was something, Dale, that I was very fortunate to grow up in California, where that was really the tradition. I grew up listening to Vin Scully and Dick Enberg and Bill King. And then later, when I moved up to Santa Rosa in 1979, listening to the great Bay Area broadcasters and, of course, Bill and Lon in 81. And so there's been a tradition of kind of playing it down the middle. And nobody doubted that Bill wanted the A's to win and that, you know, when the A's did something extremely well, he got very excited. And it was appropriate that he got excited. But Roy Eisenhart said, when I talked to Roy, that you have to, you know, one thing to remember, when Bill and Lon got hired in 1981, the A's had reached their nadir as a franchise. They were buried. They had no credibility whatsoever. And Roy said that he did not want Bill to shade the broadcasts in the direction that would lead the broadcast down that homerism path, because they really felt that the credibility was the most important thing that Bill and Lon brought to the broadcast. And so Bill was his own man. And that was, you know, one of the most incredibly wonderful things about him that I think rubbed off on me, even going back to before I met him. He lived life on his own terms. You were not going to tell Bill what to do. And so those convictions came across in all of his broadcasts.
And I've heard someone once say of Bill, Ken, that he was a very private man, as you mentioned, and especially when it came to talking about himself. So, I mean, how cooperative has his family been in assisting you on the book project?
Very much so. You know, Nancy passed away a year before Bill did. But one of the things that Steve Kettman and I did when we first started getting involved in this project, we spent a wonderful day. We had lunch with Hank Greenwald in San Francisco, because if you go back through the years, I don't think Bill had a closer friend in the world than Hank. And Bill and Nancy and Hank and his wife Carla spent a lot of time together. And so spending that, we spent about an hour and a half and recorded a bunch of stuff with Hank. It kind of kicked off the book. And then Steve and I had dinner with Kathleen, with Bill's daughter Kathleen, and her husband at a wonderful restaurant up in Sausalito. And it was very important that we got Kathleen's blessing, because, and I think that they were so close, Kathleen and Bill, that like any daughter would do, you know, you want to guard his legacy, and you want to make sure that if someone is doing a book about someone who you're that close with, that you want to make sure that the perspective is being, that it's being done in the correct way. And I think that Steve and I are both thrilled that Kathleen has certainly gotten on board with the project, and Johnny, you know, Bill's son, you know, through Nancy, they've been great. And they've been very helpful. We've exchanged some emails back and forth and kind of pointed us in directions where we felt like they could add some assistance. So they've been wonderful. We can't thank them enough.
And just like the painting that's on the Holy Toledo, your book Facebook page, you're getting a lot of neat memorabilia for the project from them as well, right, Ken?
Yeah, well, Steve was up there last week, and they actually went through a lot of Bill's old stuff, and he... My understanding of Bill is that he never threw anything away. and that there are scorebooks and notebooks and things that go back to the early 60s. And I think that, you know, if Kathy and Johnny were so disposed, they could almost do a Bill King museum and include all those Bill King artifacts from back over the years, and obviously his paintings. I had seen photographs of his paintings, but had never actually seen any of them firsthand. And Dale, he was a wonderful painter. I mean, he was a world-class painter.
Yeah, I saw. And wrapping this up with Ken Korach, once again, thank you for joining us, Ken. About 8 years ago, on October 18th, 2005, Bill passed away in San Leandro, California. Besides his death, that hit home because I grew up in that city. And I read an article where you described his death at the time as devastating. And without giving away too much from the book, describe Bill's final season calling games for the A's, Ken.
Well, it was a tough deal, Dale, as I'm sitting in a hotel room in Phoenix. It was in the spring of 05 that actually tripped on his briefcase. It was his briefcase or his suitcase, but I believe it was his briefcase that he was in his hotel room in Phoenix. And he had a hip replacement. It was well before we were paired together in 96. And he wrenched that hip replacement when he tripped in the hotel room during the spring of 05. And as you'll recall, Dale, he didn't do a lot of traveling that year with us. I know he did the games in San Francisco. He may have gone on one trip east or to the Midwest, and then we finished the season in Seattle, and he did go up and travel to do those games. But he was very limited in terms of the games that he did on the road. He did do the home games, and that's when Bill and Kathleen became, not that they weren't close before then, but Kathleen drove Bill to the ballpark every day, and that was a wonderful father-daughter experience. They shared so much during that time. And, you know, I thought he was wonderful. I did not think that he had missed a beat. Listen, he was well up in his mid to late 70s at that point. But I thought he still had the passion and the desire. And when Bill went in for the hip surgery in October, he was intent on coming back and working a full schedule the next year. Bill had such a zest for life, Dale, that nothing was going to hold him back. And even at that point in his life and his age, he was full bore going into that surgery with the hopes that his hip situation would be corrected and he would come back and he'd work a full season the next year or so. It was devastating. And, you know, I miss him every day as a partner, but I also miss him as a friend because we just share such a wonderful friendship.
The forthcoming book is called Holy Toledo, Lessons from Bill King, Renaissance Man of the Mic, authored by Ken Korach and published by Wellstone Books. I'm highly anticipating this book, and it's going to be a must-read. Even after this interview with Ken, I want to learn more about the great Bill King. And knowing Ken, this book is not about inflating his bank account. It's about paying homage to the legend that's Bill King. Ken, any final thoughts on the book? I know there's a Facebook page for the book. You're getting for a lot of updates about the book, a lot of news. It's at Holy Toledo and the title of the book. You have a big-time illustrator that's going to do the cover of the book as well. So lots going on with it in a positive way. Any final thoughts on the book for the listeners?
Well, Steve Kevin's done a remarkable job with that Facebook page. I'm an absolute zero when it comes to those kinds of things. So He's been great, and you know, I've really enjoyed reading a lot of the comments on there, and we've both been blown away by the response to the page, which just speaks to, I guess, it's validation for why we're doing this project,
sure.
Dale. The one thing we had a lot of questions about when the book will be published, and the answer is that we don't know. I'm hopeful that we can get the book out at some point during the baseball season. There's a lot of work that still has to be done. And as you know, I'm getting involved with broadcasting games. We have a broadcast to do on Saturday. But our hope is that this book will be finished and will be out sometime before the midpoint in the baseball season. But I think it's the most important thing from our standpoint, and it's a little intimidating. I think we both feel that this way, as I mentioned to you earlier, Dale, is try to capture Bill. Try to do it right and to do Bill King justice, and so that the fans will have a good experience when they get a chance to read it.
That's Ken Korach. I'm Dale Tafoya, and thank you for joining us on another episode of Athletics After Dark as we celebrate the past and future of Oakland A's baseball. Thanks, Ken.
Thank you, Dale.